Now I'm glad to introduce Mr. Anand Banka. He's also a CA, and he's having his own firm in Mumbai as Talati and Talati, and it is about 25 firms are there all over India, and 250 people are working under him. And I would also like to tell you that he has delivered more than 150 lectures on various topics, including IFRS, Indian Accounting Standards, USGAAP, etc., for corporates and other institutes in India and abroad. And he's a faculty for ICAI certificate course on IFRS. He's also co-opted member of the ICAI WIRC committee for IFRS implementation in India, and a member of Chamber of Tax Consultation for Allied Laws Committee. He's also a special invitee for Accounting Standard Board of ICAI. So I would like to hand over to Mr. Anand Banka to take the lectures.
Okay, second day and last session. The topic I'll be taking is accounting for government grants. Okay, now before I start, what do you understand by the term government grants, or what exactly grants do we receive in educational institutes? What kind of? There can be monetary grants, there can be non-monetary grants. What are the kind of monetary grants we receive? What are the kind of non-monetary grants we receive? Grants for creation of capital assets, okay. Maintenance grants, grants for salaries. So there can be revenue grants, there can be capital grants. Okay. What about non-monetary grants? These are all monetary grants for capital creation, maintenance, or salaries. Land, building, so basically assets. Okay. See, basically there is a accounting standard 12, accounting for government grants, which we are discussing. The purpose or basic function is of the government is to promote economic and industrial development. Now, how does it do such a job of development, economic and industrial development? It discharges its duty by undertaking activities, promotional activities. It might be promotion of a particular area or giving incentives, specific incentives, special incentives, which might be in form of tax breaks. Okay, like 80IA, 80IB, income tax sections, these are. Then there are other grants. So it can be tax breaks or the grants which we have just discussed. Okay, and why do you need this standard? Now, there are two main reasons. One is appropriate method of accounting of such grants, and because or by way of appropriate accounting, what can happen is the readers of those financial statements can better understand the purpose of those grants and the effect of those grants, whether positive, negative, whatever is on your financial statements. So how the reporting entity has benefited out of that grants and how to account those grants. These are the two main reasons or main topics which AS-12 talks about. It deals with capital and revenue grants only from government agencies. Now we are here, the audience is only government sponsored institutes. So this is relevant only to us. Any institute receiving private grants, then this standard does not cover any private grants, accounting for private grants. That will be covered by your standard on revenues. Okay, it will not be covered by AS-12. Now, grants can be in form of monetary, non-monetary, as we were discussing. Monetary grants can be subsidies, cash incentives, duty drawbacks. Non-monetary can be land or other assets or resources. Now, what this statement or this standard does not cover is accounting for government grants in financial statements reflecting the effect of changing prices. Now, this is not relevant in India per se. There are standards, or there are countries, basically standards made for those countries which are hyperinflationary. Hyperinflationary is, what is hyperinflationary? Where the inflation is hyper. Hyperinflationary means the inflation rates are varying very widely. Okay, for those there are different standards. Okay, not in Indian accounting standards, there are internationally there are standards for such countries. From Indian point of view, it is not relevant, and hence this standard excludes accounting in those kind of statements. It excludes government assistance other than in form of government grants. That means, see, we said grants includes tax holidays, but this standard or this statement will not cover those forms of grants which is in form of tax holidays, like 80IA, 80IB, 80HHC. There are various sections under which government gives tax holidays or grants, assistance basically. Those kind of assistance will not be accounted for under this section or this standard. And it will not cover government participation in ownership of the enterprise. That means if government purchases any share capital or government is owner or part owner of that enterprise, that ownership transaction is not covered by this standard. So these are the three specific instances where this standard will not touch upon. Okay, now let's come to the main standard. The definition of government grant. What is a government grant? Government grant can be assistance by government in cash or kind for past or future compliance of certain conditions. So there can be certain conditions which can be levied, and only if you fulfill those conditions, you will be eligible for those grants. It does not include grants which cannot be reasonably measured. That means a grant or an assistance which cannot be measured will not be accounted for under this standard. Does not include transactions with government which cannot be distinguished from normal trading transactions of an enterprise. That means, say, suppose an enterprise say deals into steel and provides steel to that to a government company. So that is not a government grant, or that is not a transaction covered by this standard. So a normal business transaction is not covered by this standard. Now government, when I say government, government includes union, state, any agency of government or similar bodies which can be at local, national or international level. These were the startup things. The main standard or the accounting procedure starts from here. Okay, now we discussed there can be two types of grant, capital grants or income grants. Okay, capital grants are grants that are treated as part of shareholders' funds or the capital funds. Revenue or income grants, or where you follow revenue or income approach, grant is taken to income over a period of time, one or more period, which can be specified when they give grants. When you account for those grants, it is dependent upon whether it is a capital grant or a revenue grant, and if a revenue grant, what is the period of that grant. Okay, let's come to capital approach first. Now capital approach says that, now as I said, you know, there are two types of grants, capital and revenue. When do we call it as a capital grant? What is a capital grant, or what do you understand by word capital? Any capital expenditure incurred is capital grant. Okay, or and any other examples? So that's what he said, capital expenditure, purchase of fixed assets. Anything else? See, investment of capital, as I said, you know, when I invest capital, that means I purchase shares, or so that is not a grant, that is investment. So investment has to be differentiated from a grant. Okay, what if I give you a grant without specifying the purpose, which type of grant it is? Okay, plan, non-plan, fine, but under the standards there are only two types. Okay, which is capital and revenue. Now whether it is plan or non-plan, I have to define it whether it is a capital or revenue. A planned expenditure or a non-plan expenditure, both can be capital or revenue, right? So we will talk in terms of capital and revenue, not in terms of plan and non-plan. Okay, so what if I give you a grant without defining the purpose? Why revenue? No, I am accounting for it when I am receiving the grant and not when I am spending the grant. So I don't know today where I will be spending that grant. Okay, so I cannot define a grant based upon my future spendings. I will define the grant based upon why the grantor or the government has given to me, the purpose for which the government has given to me, and not the purpose for which I am utilizing it.
Without any mentioning any purpose, government is releasing grant.
Yes.
Is it possible?
See.
Normally, government never leaves from without answering. Perhaps I don't think there is a single example so far that government has released and not mentioned anything what you have to do. And we have to abide by those guidelines.
Okay, let me put it this way. Okay, what if it is for a project wherein it includes both capital and revenue?
In project also, everything is mentioned very clearly what you have to do. If a project is sanctioned for 4 crores or 5 crores whatsoever, equipment, recurring, non-recurring, everything is mentioned there overhead these things.
Right. How will you categorize that grant into capital or revenue is my question.
It's already mentioned. When we receive the
absolutely accepted the point that I will have a plan for that expend that amount to be spended. That means whether I will be spending that amount on how much portion of the amount will be spent on purchase of assets, how much portion of the amount will be spent on maintenance, how much portion will be spent on revenue expenditure. I agree to that. My question is, when a grant is given for a project, a total amount or outlay is given to you, okay? And the spending is clear, fine, or the budget is approved by the government and then the grant is given. But how will you classify such kind of grant? That is my question.
Actually, that depends upon nature of expenditure of that project.
So
and grant amount mentioned in that project, it is clearly mentioned how much is under capital, how much is under revenue.
See, the problem here is accounting. Okay, see, I am speaking from accounting point of view, accounting terms, and the terms which are used by you is the government terms. Okay, the government might be defining that these are the capital expenditures you have to incur, these are the revenue expenditures you have to incur. Right. Now, the classification which you will be doing is from accounting point of view and not from the as you said, you know, the classification for budget or the spending point of view.
Now, from the sanction letter itself, it is very clear which expenditure is capital and which will be revenue.
Right.
Like equipment, always capital expenditure. If there is a provision of keeping two fellows for 2 years, that will be revenue expenditure. If there are some consumable required, that will be revenue expenditure. Like that, everything is mentioned, and depending upon the nature of expenditure, we decide whether it is capital or revenue.
So let me give you an example. Suppose there are 4 kind of expenditure which you have to incur, which is for a project, which might be, say, 2 expenditure is for capital, which is purchase of some assets. Those 2 assets will cost you, say, 60,000 rupees. Another 40,000 is for revenue expenditures, okay, which you have already defined and it is approved. Okay, so the 60,000 is for capital and 40,000 is for revenue. Now, how will you account for that total 1 lakh which you have received from government?
And 40 of the revenue head.
What head will you use for 60?
Earmark fund.
And where will you show that? Liability side. Under what head? Capital funds. Okay, and 40 how will you show?
Under revenue head.
Okay, and when will you show that under income side?
Income side.
when is my question. There are three things, right? There is timing, there is measurement, and there is recognition. Okay, recognition is income. Okay, measurement is 40,000. What is the timing?
Expenditure account.
Will you map it to the expenditure? That means 40,000 is for expenditure. 40,000 is for expenditure. That means you have specific expenditure to be incurred.
Yeah.
Right? Will you map it with expenditure? Say suppose I have incurred 5 out of 6 expenditure in the current year and 1 expenditure has we could not incur and it will be incurred in the next year.
Then the amount will be credited to the fund again. For it will be deferred revenue grant, something like that.
Now, how will you account for it?
Yes, 40 rupees you are saying it is a revenue grant. Huh. Okay. If it is over a period of 4 years, then 30 rupees I will take in.
I am not saying over the period of 4 years. I am saying it has been given for.
The expenditure will be recognized in the income and expenditure account.
Immediately.
Grants utilized for revenue expenditure. About the 40% or 40 rupees for expenditure, earmarked for expenditure, will be reflected in the income and expenditure account.
When is my question?
When you have utilized it, to the extent utilized.
And what happens to that portion which has not been utilized?
That will be
the surplus. Current year maine utilized hua, my question wo hai.
That will be a surplus, sir.
When we receive the 1 lakh rupee for government India, first we pass the voucher and create the liability, grant in aid. This first we create the liability.
Right.
And suppose we incur the expenditure, 60 lakh rupee for equipment and 40 lakh rupee for contingency expenditure. All 1 lakh rupee is used, so we pass the general voucher. That liability should be reduced and that should be taken into income. And from income, 40,000 rupees recurring expenditure and 60,000 rupees is the capital expenditure. Then we submit the utilization certificate to Government of India for total 1 lakh rupees. This is the procedure we are following in MNIT Bhopal.
Right. My question is, what if you are not able to utilize that 40,000 which is meant for revenue in the current year and suppose one expenditure you will incur in the next year?
Sir, for that year, we show the unutilized grant. That is the liability for us. When we utilize, then only we transfer into income. Otherwise, that is the liability for the institute.
Right.
So because if we not utilize amount, that it is mandatory to refund the Government of India.
So unless
that time it is a liability.
Okay. So I'll just summarize whatever we have discussed and correct me if I am wrong in this. 1 lakh is the total which you have received, out of which 60,000 will be used for fixed assets, 40,000 will be used for revenue. Okay. Now out of this 40,000, say suppose, now this 40,000 will go to entirely liability when you receive it. Right? So cash account debit to liability when you receive it. Right? Now when you start spending it, every time you spend something, okay, you transfer the similar amount to income. So your entry at that time is liability debit to income. Whatever remains unutilized in the current year will remain in the liability over here. Right? Okay. Now what happens to the fixed assets part? 60,000 which you have received for fixed assets, you will reflect in?
That also taken in the income and that reflect into capital fund and asset.
So this 60,000 will entirely go to capital fund, you are saying?
Yeah.
And what happens after you utilize it?
Then capital asset will appear on the fixed asset side. Then the fixed asset will appear on the fixed asset side.
First entry is cash account debit to capital fund.
Huh.
And the next entry is fixed asset account debit to bank. So equal amount and the balance sheet, on the capital fund side 60 rupees will appear, on the asset side 60 rupees will appear. So the balance sheet will tally.
So you are saying that if I have a balance sheet, FA will be 60
and capital fund will be 60.
60.
Yeah.
Okay. And now, then you keep depreciating this fixed asset.
Now if I provide depreciation, then depreciation account debit to fixed asset. And then again the depreciation will be charged to the capital fund. And so for that, one entry will be capital fund account debit to income and expenditure account.
So, so one entry will be depreciation to fixed assets.
Yes.
Say 6 rupees.
Yes. For then example, another, there right? will be another entry, capital fund account debit to income and expenditure.
Capital fund?
Debit to income and expenditure. So, so in the balance sheet, depreciation amount will be deducted from the fixed asset as well as from the capital fund.
So, so basically, if I draw a P&L, I will see a depreciation
both
over
side,
here 6
both side.
And income over here as 6.
6.
Is that so?
Yes, yes, it is.
Okay.
Because depreciation against any capital fund is a charge against capital fund, not against IE, income expenditure.
Okay.
So in the balance sheet, against depreciation will be deducted from the fixed asset as well as from the capital fund. So the net fixed asset and capital fund balance will tally.
Okay. This is the practice everywhere in all the institutes. Okay. Now, now this is not what AS-12 says. Total, total 100 is credited total, to income and expenditure account.
No, total revenue grant is credited to income expenditure, and the shortfall is going to capital. Net effect, effect is same, but to that extent, okay. The capital is reduced.
Okay, let me tell you what AS-12 says. Okay, then we'll discuss how to move towards AS-12 from the current approach. Okay, now AS-12 says capital grants or capital approach. It says as capital approach and revenue approach. There are two approaches which you can follow. Okay, capital approach says whatever you have received as a for a specific project, which includes both capital and revenue. One of the options is you consider it as promoter's contribution. That means everything goes to capital funds. Okay. If you have received for a specific fixed asset, then again, what you do is you take fixed assets to capital fund. This is called as what you just mentioned. This is called as capital approach. Okay, you book fixed assets and you take to capital capital funds. Okay. However, when you follow this approach, you do not reverse this depreciation of 6 which you pass capital to income, capital fund to income. This entry which you have passed, this second entry. This entry, this is reversal. Okay, this reversal does not happen if you follow capital approach. Okay. So what it says is if you have received any grant for fixed assets, okay, you do these two things. Option one and option two. Option one says I recognize fixed asset at rupee 1. Okay, I don't recognize full value of fixed assets and full value of grant. Okay. If FA is recognized at rupee 1, I will not depreciate it. I will not book any income or grant or anything. My balance sheet is anyways tallied. Okay, because I have received 100% of the grant from government. The other option it says is FA I recognize at 60. And liability, not capital fund. Liability I recognize at 60. Then I depreciate this FA. This entry is normal, which we anyways pass. The second entry from liability will go to depreciation. It will not go to income. That means my entry will be liability. That means I will not have a depreciation expense in P&L in this case. See, what happens in the case where I book depreciation and income is, I am having both expenditure and income. There is a depreciation and there is an income. It says that you set off that depreciation with income.
How does it make difference? Because it is a non-fund item.
When I am debiting income expenditure account is unnecessarily burdened on account because it is a charge against capital fund. That's why I am passing an adjustment entry, debiting the capital fund and creating the IE, and it is a non-fund item. I think it doesn't make any difference.
See, in the options which I have also mentioned, there is no charge to your income and expenditure account in both the options.
But at the same time,
in both the options,
but at the same time, it is not also logical when you are charging something to depreciation, it will not be shown in the income expenditure account.
I am reversing that depreciation. I am taking out some portion of liability
in the depreciation
and
ledger
crediting
you are reversing.
The depreciation.
You are in the depreciation ledger account, you are reversing, but you are not showing to the P&L, IE.
Because the P&L, I will show net depreciation account, net amount of depreciation. So IE will not have any expenditure because of depreciation, because this fixed asset which I have received is a grant from the government, I have not incurred any expenditure, so there should be no depreciation.
Fine, whatever depreciation you are charging, you are nullifying by passing an adjustment entry.
Right. So the problem here is the difference is, see, although the net profit will remain same in all the three options.
Yeah, net profit will remain same.
Net profit will remain same. But in the option which you are following, you are inflating both income and expenditure. I am utilizing from the grant of 60. So my grant, so after this entry, my closing balance sheet will look like this. FA 54 and grant, which is my liability, which is this, will also be 54. This is my closing balance sheet.
I was saying that for accounting of the capital grant, to the extent utilized for expenditure, it is transferred to the capital fund.
Not the entire grant.
If say out of 60,000, 10,000 is spent on procurement of asset. To that extent only, the grant is transferred to the capital fund and the remaining portion remains in the liability till it is utilized, of course. So this is how it is. And the depreciation charge on assets is taken to the income and expenditure account, that the depreciation charge on the asset is taken to the income and expenditure account, and the net surplus or deficit, whatever, is taken to the capital fund. This is how it is.
Your question is basically, if I have not utilized the grant meant for fixed asset, you're saying?
Yes, the capital, I was saying that the treatment of capital grant, to the extent utilized for procurement of asset, is transferred from the grant account, liability account, to the capital fund. To the extent utilized for procurement
of
asset.
To the capital fund?
Yes.
And then what do you do with that fund? You will depreciate fixed asset?
That of course it will be done.
And then will there be a reversal of that capital fund to income and expenditure?
See,
to the extent of depreciation?
Depreciation is taken to the income and expenditure account on the expenditure side.
Right.
And the net result of the income and expenditure account is taken to the capital fund. The net deficit or surplus.
For that asset?
Yes. No. The net result of the income and expenditure account, which is surplus or deficit, is taken to capital fund.
But then in that case, your surplus or deficit
is
higher, because depreciation you have charged.
Yes, of course.
But you have not taken out that 6 rupees from capital fund and credited to income. So your income and expenditure will show a lower surplus or higher deficit by 6 rupees.
I don't understand. I'm not following you.
Okay. You're saying that suppose I have received 60,000 rupees for spending on fixed assets.
Yes.
So that will be shown as liability.
Yes.
Right? Now, I have bought a fixed asset for 40,000 rupees.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
So what you will do is, you will remove 40 from here and you will show capital fund of 40,000.
Yes.
And the liability will remain 20,000.
Yes.
Right till here?
Okay.
Then you're saying I will pass a depreciation entry on that 40,000 of say 4.
Okay.
Right?
Yes. Yes.
Okay. And then what do you do?
Depreciation 4 rupees is taken to income and expenditure account.
Yes. Right. So suppose income and expenditure, I have an income of 100 throughout the year.
Yes.
And I have a depreciation of 4.
Yes.
So my net surplus is 96.
Okay.
You're saying I take this to capital fund and make it 4096.
Yes, that's right.
Okay. So that's what I am saying, that this is not allowed as per accounting standard 12. This is wrong method of accounting, because this 4 rupees, see, this entire 40,000 is a grant from government. You have not incurred this expenditure. Okay. Because you have not incurred this expenditure, you have got it for free. You cannot have a charge to your income and expenditure account for something which you have got for free.
What do you mean by saying free?
Free in the sense government sponsored.
Yes.
Because it is government sponsored, there is no expenditure which has been incurred by you. It is government giving you that expenditure.
See, please.
Sector.
This is only for government grant, whether received by corporates or whether received by government.
Sir.
Specific to government sector, not to your accounting firm.
No. This standard can be for, is applicable to all the companies, whether private or government, but only with respect to grant received from government.
Sir.
Hence, it's called government grants and not private grants or grants.
Sir, this is the treatment that I have just mentioned. This is
see, because of this, you know, your profits are reducing to by 96, and because profits are reducing to 96, you will pay a lower tax on 96.
According to the format of annual accounts, which was introduced in 2005-06 or 2004-05, on accrual basis. This was the practice which was suggested, or rather approved by the Institute of Chartered Accountants, and was also CAG, all approved this practice, and they suggested in the format of accounts, and this is accordingly applied and used. One point of course remains there. Initially you mentioned the grants for projects. There's a bit of confusion over the terminology, projects. We use sponsored projects. Sponsored project is a different term, and the grants which we normally take are non-planned grants, which is simple, the recurring type generally, and the sponsored projects are altogether different type of thing. It is not a grant. It is not a grant to the institution. The amount received for sponsored project is not a grant to the institution. Okay, so that's a different issue. And the grants to the institution are only non-planned grants or planned grants. Or maybe sometimes...
I'll tell you what you are schemes. Referring to. See, when I spoke over here, capital approach or income or this approach, income or revenue approach, capital approach, one of the contribution can be promoter's contribution, which you are referring to. If it is, see, he's saying that in one of the years, his institute received a grant for a project, okay, which was not a plan or non-planned expenditure. It was completely for a project, and that entire grant was treated as promoter's contribution. When you receive a grant for promoter's contribution or as promoter's contribution, that grant is taken directly to capital fund, and whatever expenditure you incur, whether on fixed assets or P&L, then you do not credit or you do not take out anything from that capital fund. See, you are never allowed to take out anything from the capital fund. Never. Once anything goes to capital fund, it remains over there. Okay, you cannot take out depreciation or anything out of capital fund. You can take it out of liability. Till the time it is there in the liability, or as a deferred revenue, or as any form of liability, you can take out things and you can take it to P&L or income and expenditure account. Okay, promoter's contribution goes directly to capital fund. The other approach is where I said where it is for a specific fixed asset. Now, any monetary grant received for a specific fixed asset, there are only two options available under AS-12. Those two options are either you take entire fixed asset at 1 rupee. Okay, you don't value it. You don't take it at the cost value. You take it at 1 rupee, which is the nominal value, or you book 60 rupees, the cost of asset on the asset side, and the grant which is received against it on the liability side. Then you depreciate that fixed asset, take it to depreciation, which is the expenditure, and then you take out similar amount from the liability and credit your depreciation. So depreciation becomes zero for that particular asset, and there is no charge in income and expenditure account for that particular asset. These are the two things which falls under capital approach.
For presentation of income and expenditure, there are the observation of government audit.
that depreciation has to be routed through income and expenditure account.
Absolutely.
So we have to debit the expenditure side of depreciation and equal amount we have to show in the deferred income in the income and expenditure. That's what the government audit has observed.
You have to net it off. So when you present it in your income and expenditure account, you will net off the income with the depreciation and depreciation will be lower by that amount. So you will charge depreciation on 60, you will take it to depreciation account and then you will charge similar 6 rupees to your liability and credit your depreciation account.
Sir, I have some 2-3 fundamental clarification on this accounting grant. One is in the exclusion class you have told participation as owner is excluded.
Exposure draft of?
In the exclusion class, 3 exclusions
exclusion,
you have given. Yeah, you have told participation as owner. We have to understand what is the relationship between the autonomous bodies and the government. Whether is it a owner entity relationship or something. If it is owner entity, it is not applicable.
Right.
And next one, the very term says that government grant. Indirectly implying it is applicable to non-government organization.
Anything which is given as ownership is not a government grant.
So if the all the universities, IIT, vis-a-vis the government relationship is something like owner, then this grant, this accounting standard may not be applicable.
No, it's not so. Amount given as ownership. Okay, if I give any amount to the trust as ownership, if I give any amount to the institution as ownership,
That means the grant what we are receiving is something similar to ownership entity relationship only, because we are putting in the capital not as liability what you are saying grant. We are not showing it as liability. We are showing it as capital all the grant. So in that case, it is indirectly implying that there is a ownership relationship
which
exists.
Which grant you are talking about, revenue or capital? What is the grant utilized for, or what is the grant given for?
Capital grant.
Capital for purchase of fixed assets?
No, the grant we are getting, sir, for an entire plan period, we are getting some 300 crores. Maybe if 200 crores is for the acquisition of land and fixed assets, we are showing it as capital. So indirectly meaning that government is the owner of the IIT or central universities. So when this grant exclusion class says that participation as owner, in that case, this grant, this accounting standard is not applicable. When
I say exclusion, I am not saying the accounting standard is not applicable to things. I am saying these transactions.
Yeah, this transaction.
This transaction accounting standard is not applicable. The transaction where the amount has come in as purchase of shares or as purchase of ownership rights in the institution. Now, does that amount give ownership right to the government?
Yeah,
or is the amount given as grant to be utilized by the institution in a specified way with conditions that yes, you have to utilize for this purpose, yes, you have to utilize for this purpose?
Yeah, it comes like that only. No?
So
that
then it is not a ownership grant. It will not fall in this third point because it is given to be utilized for specific points. It is not given as...
No, it is generally only it is given for acquisition of fixed assets land like that. University or IITs are established based on that grant.
We'll discuss your case separately because your case is different from all other cases.
And
we'll not,
one more point I have, sir. This very term government grant we are using means is it applicable to only to non-government organizations?
See, government grants means grants given by government, given to anyone. Grants given by government, given to anyone, then you have to follow this standard. Giver, the person who gives is government. The person who receives, it's not mentioning anything. That means anyone who receives a grant from the government has to follow this standard.
So, or else can we assume that the relationship is something like that of a promoter to a company?
See, we'll discuss your point separately. Okay. We'll not mix with everyone, otherwise we'll waste time. Yes?
Okay. Sir, I have a... So what you are explaining, that capital approach, when we receive the grants for capital capital assets or fixed assets creation, we show it on the fixed asset side as fixed assets grant, and on the liability side as a liability. Now we have utilized that grant, fixed assets are created and utilization is there, the amount can be transferred from liability to the capital fund. First question. 1 minute.
Let me complete.
And the approach which you explained, that fixed assets have been created, now the grants stand fully utilized and depreciation question comes. At that point of time, because fixed assets are to be shown as rupee 1 and the grants also are to be shown almost utilized, nothing is to be refunded. In that situation, the depreciation charge will not be there at all.
Right.
It will not be there at all. But none of the organization has been following this kind of practice. So it will need more clarification and more clarity on this aspect. Because it's a big departure from what we have been following.
See, standard gives you two options. You can follow any of the options and both options are right options. Okay. The first option which I said is you record it at nominal value which is rupee 1. Okay. That is one option. Second option is you record it at full value and on the other hand you create a liability of full value. Right. So you can, both the options are correct. There is no incorrect option amongst these two. Now if you are following the second option of recording the full value of fixed assets and recording the full value of liability, you are still correct. So I am not asking you to change from option 2 to option 1.
If we keep full value and then depreciation is charged, then suppose 60 rupees grant which was shown and 6 rupees depreciation is charged, then assets will appear at 54.
Right.
This side also, the liability side also, it will appear at
54. 54. Right. Right.
You were explaining that in the morning session also it was explained that 54 is like a deferred income.
Right.
Next year again 6 rupees.
Right. Absolutely. Absolutely.
48 will come and then it will.
Both sides 48. Absolutely.
Every year.
Absolutely. Yes. So that's an option two which I am saying, which is also correct. So only thing which I was referring to is depreciation and the income, both should knock off.
In that situation, there will be no entry in income and expenditure account.
Absolutely.
Only six.
Entry, basically both the entries will go to income and expenditure and knock off. The net effect is nil.
Yeah, net effect is nil.
Right. Right. See, what you all are doing is you all are inflating income and expenditure both. I am saying you both become zero. Right?
Sir, one question. Suppose I have created the asset not from the grants, for example. I have created the asset from the internal resources. Now the entry is fixed asset account debit to bank.
Right.
Right. Now, whether that fixed asset forms promoter's contribution, can I debit income expenditure and create the capital fund for the equal amount?
No.
Because there are some university and institution who does not get government grant because they does not require also.
Right.
Because their capital reserve has crossed more than few thousand crore.
Right. Okay. Right. Right.
Now, in that cases, they are generating fixed assets from their internal resources.
Right.
So, suppose I have bought a furniture amounting to 100 rupees. Whether that 100 rupees will form promoter's contribution?
No. Is the promoter giving you contribution? You are utilizing your own surplus.
Yeah.
You cannot utilize your own surplus and create promoter's contribution. Promoter is not giving you contribution.
Promoter's contribution means capital funds, I am saying. In government organization, there is no promoter.
Exactly, I understand. But you cannot create capital funds out of your surplus.
But I am from IIM Calcutta, some of IIM is following this practice.
That is wrong practice.
See, I am just sharing.
What is the accounting entry which you will do?
We debit the income expenditure and create the capital fund for the equal amount. We are debiting income expenditure account for equal amount and creating capital fund.
For the depreciation amount?
No. The original principal amount.
No, I'm not getting. 1 second. Suppose my fixed asset is 60 rupees. Okay, first of all, you spend 60 rupees to bank or cash, 60 rupees.
Yeah.
This is entry number one.
Entry number two,
you are saying is income and expenditure debit.
Capital fund 60 rupees.
So basically, you are creating a charge to income and expenditure account.
Yeah.
Is this correct? You tell me. So if any institute is doing this kind of accounting entry, it is wrong. Fine? Okay.
Right now, we are including it in capital fund. But it is to be segregated. Segregated and the deferred income kind of thing is.
Right. Absolutely. So logically, you are not allowed to recoup anything out of capital funds.
No adjustment is allowed to be made.
Yes.
That's why separate head is to be kept on the.
Right.
All adjustment in subsequent years or future year also is to be made out of that.
Right.
Not from capital.
Right. Okay. There are few examples which I have put in slides. Okay. Method one is the option one which I was talking about, which none of you all follow, but I'll just discuss it. Specific fixed asset, if you have received grant, the amount of grant is deducted from the gross value of asset, thus recognized in P&L by way of reduced depreciation charge. Reduced depreciation charge means out of 100, if I have received 60, so 60 rupees will be deducted from 100 and 40 rupees will be my fixed asset. If I have received entire 100 rupees, then my fixed asset will be at 1 rupee. Okay, where the grant equals the whole of the cost of the asset is shown as nominal value, which is 1 rupee. Okay, so for example, Z Limited purchased a fixed asset for 50 lakhs, estimated useful life 5 years, salvage value 5 lakhs, government grant is 10 lakhs. So basically what will I do? I will record at 40 lakhs and I will depreciate 40 lakhs, 40 minus 5, 35 lakhs over 5 years. 7 lakhs is my depreciation. If I had received entire 50 lakhs, then I would have recorded at 1 rupee and hence no depreciation. Okay. These are my accounting entries in this case wherein I received 10 lakhs as grant. Okay. This is the method 2 which we were discussing right now, option 2 which we all follow. Okay. So let's discuss this in detail. Now there can be two types of assets it says. It can be depreciable assets, there can be non-depreciable assets. Non-depreciable assets means land, which we cannot depreciate. Depreciable assets means anything else, your factory, furniture, building or whatever, anything else. Okay. Now, depreciable assets, it is treated as deferred income, as I was saying, as a liability, deferred income. Okay. Recognized in the profit and loss statement on a systematic and rational basis over the useful life of the asset, in the proportion in which depreciation is charged. Fine? If it is non-depreciable asset, that means land. Now land you do not depreciate. If you create a deferred revenue expenditure, that deferred revenue expenditure will never go to P&L or your income and expenditure because there is no corresponding depreciation. See, if it is a depreciable asset, okay, how am I taking the deferred revenue expenditure to my income and expenditure account? In the proportion of depreciation. Over the proportion of depreciation. If there was no depreciation, I will not be able to take this deferred revenue expenditure to P&L. So deferred revenue expenditure will always stay in deferred revenue expenditure, which is not right. Hence, if the asset is non-depreciable, then you take it to capital reserve or capital fund. If the asset is a land, okay, this 60,000 which we are speaking about, if that is a land, okay, then land will not be depreciated. Okay, so what I will do is I will create land at 60,000 and I will create capital fund of 60,000. I will not create deferred revenue in that case. Only where it is a depreciable fixed asset, I will create an asset of 60,000 and a deferred revenue expenditure of 60,000. That's what I explained. Why difference? Because if I create, okay, this is my balance sheet, okay, I have a land 60,000, okay, suppose I create a deferred revenue expenditure like in any other case, okay. Of 60,000, right? What do I do about it in the next year? If it was not land, okay, I would have depreciated it by say 6,000, right? And I would have taken 6,000 to income and expenditure account. So both would have become 54. And in a similar manner, one day it would have become zero. Right? For cases which is not land, you are saying for depreciable asset cases. That's what I am saying. See, anything which you take to capital fund, anything which is capital, okay, capital is not meant to be taken back to P&L. Anything which you take to capital, generally anything which is gone to capital should not go to P&L, should not go to income and expenditure. Ek bar wo capital mein chala gaya, it should remain in capital. Hence, you do not take something to capital which is again going back to income. Now, this I know is going back to income. Hence, I should not treat it as capital fund. I should treat it as deferred revenue expenditure, which should be in my liability and not capital.
How this is treating as deferred revenue?
It is treated as deferred revenue. Okay, let me come to the basics. What is a fixed asset? Why do you depreciate a fixed asset? Okay, can I give you a different theory to depreciation? Okay, have you heard of something called as matching concept? What is a matching concept? Current year income should match with current year expenditure. Okay, when I say match, it means that anything I have earned and anything which is gone for earning that income, both should come together. That is matching. Right? Now, I have used these fixed assets to earn some income. Right? When I have used these fixed assets to earn some income, there should be some expense because I am using this fixed asset. That expense is depreciation. Right? Okay, this is matching concept. I have used this asset to earn some income. Hence, some part of this asset which I have used in the current year should go to my expenditure, which I take it as a depreciation. Now, you may call it as wear and tear of that asset, or you may call it by any other name, but it is basically a matching concept logically. Okay. Now, I have received an amount for this fixed asset. So, there is a 60,000 which I have spent. Say, this is not land, this is any other asset, right? So, I have spent something for a fixed asset, 60,000 rupees, and I have got that amount of 60,000 rupees. Okay. Now, I am saying that either I do not record both of them because I have received at a rupee 1 or 0. Okay. Or if I want to record, I record both of them. Okay. Now, if I record this, they will be charged to P&L. There will be charge to P&L, whereas there should be no charge to P&L in my logic because I have not spent this, I have received this amount. Hence, I have to take a similar amount to P&L so that P&L is zero for this depreciation. How do I do that? If I want to take 60,000 to P&L over, say, life is 5 years of this asset. So, I am using this asset for 5 years. I have spent 60,000 for 5 years. And I have received 60,000, so I have to spend, I have to record this income also over 5 years. Because I have to record this income over 5 years, it is my revenue and it is deferred for 5 years. Hence, it is deferred revenue.
Sir, if it is income, sir, then it should be charged in the income and expenditure account. No, sir, it will not be in the balance sheet.
See, deferred revenue is the deferred part. So, at the end of the year, it is 54. 54 is what? Something which is deferred. 6,000 is what? Something which is recorded, earned in the current year. So, anything which is deferred will have to go to balance sheet, right? Jo aage push kar diya, wo balance sheet mein rahega. Jo current year mein earn kar diya, record kar diya, wo income mein jayega.
Suppose if one asset's depreciation rate is 1%, then that means that 100 years it will be deferred income or deferred revenue.
So, this will also be at 1%. If this is 1%, this is also 1%.
Then, sir, it will go like 100 years, like, yes, like deferred.
If asset will go for 100 years.
Is it, sir, deferred expenditures definition that it will 100 years it will go as, then what will be about fixed assets?
Then
what is about fixed assets?
So I am asking you to show it as liability.
Assets are acquired out of grants as well as other sources.
Grants not from government, from other sources.
No, okay, I understand. Once assets are acquired, whether out of grants or any other sources, and they are put together, they become property of the university.
Right.
And the treatment of depreciation, etc., is on overall.
For all the assets.
So it right. Is practically, is it possible to differentiate between assets created out of grants and then take them separately and then rest of the assets
portion of the assets. So, this is what I was trying to raise.
Okay, I'll tell you why is it required to do that. Okay, what if suppose after 5 years, this asset is stolen or asset is sold or anything happens. So I'm saying, see, depreciation, I'm taking 6 years, that means 6,000, that means 10 years, right? Suppose after 5 years, something happens to this asset, say fire or stolen or sold or whatever, then what will you do? This asset is gone then, okay? What happens to this part? Where will it go? See, where will you take this? So you have a balance of 30,000 after 5 years, right? When it gets stolen or fire or something happens, your entry will be expenditure debit, 30,000 to fixed asset, right? Now what if this was in a capital fund? You will reverse capital fund? Yes, to income. That means you are tracking it by asset, right? Will you or will you not reverse the capital fund by 30,000? You will, right? That means you are anyways tracking this asset by asset. So where is the question of practically possible to track or not? You have to track.
But sir, one point I just want to mention that assets.
See, why did I answer? His question was, is it practically possible to track each asset,
yes,
grant wise? If it is not possible, will you be able to reverse the capital fund which you are, the accounting which you are doing right now, you are taking it to capital fund. What if this situation arises in your institution, will you reverse the capital fund by 30,000? If yes, that means you are anyways tracking it asset by asset, or anyways required to do that, and you will have to do that. You have no option. So as I was saying, it is credited to capital. If it is non-depreciable, it is credited to capital reserve directly, because now you are not going to depreciate the land and you are not going to take out anything out of that grant. So it will go to capital fund. Okay, let's go to revenue grants. Okay, any other grant other than specific fixed assets or capital grant is revenue grant. Okay, revenue grant is taken to other income in income and expenditure account as and when you incur the expenditures. So when you incur the expenditure, you incur the cost, so expenditure to cash. At the same time, you take that grant to income. So your entry will be income, liability debit to income. I'll just write the accounting entries for you. So basically, say suppose I have received grant of 40,000, right? Out of which I have incurred expenditure of say 15,000. So my normal entry is expenditure. First, when I receive the grant, what is the entry I pass when I receive the grant? Bank or cash to grants, right? Where do I show these grants? This is liability. When I receive the grants, this is shown on liability side. Till the time I have not incurred the expenditure, I have not utilized the money, till the time I have not utilized the money, this is my liability, because unutilized portion I will have to return back.
Utilized or unutilized is decided at the year.
Right. So when you,
in our university, total expenditure is 100 rupees and our internal income generation is suppose 10 rupees. Government is sanctioning 100 rupees grants, less income generation 10 rupees, 90 rupees the government is releasing grants.
Right.
So in that case, what will be the entry?
When do you receive the grant?
Throughout the year.
Throughout the year,
in
you
different installments they are getting, suppose 4 installments you take.
Do you receive grants in advance or do you receive grants after incurring the expenditure?
Throughout the year, from where I will incur the expenditure, I do not have money. My total expenditure is 100 rupees.
So you receive
internal
grants in advance.
Internal income is 10 rupees. Government is sanctioning grants 100 rupees, less 10 rupees internal income generation, 90 rupees government is releasing throughout the year right. in four installments.
So you
what will be the entry?
So you receive grant in advance, right? Before incurring the expense, you receive the grant. What is the entry you pass when you receive the grant? Say you received out of 90 rupees, you received 30 rupees on the first day. What will be the entry you pass when you receive that 30 rupees?
Bank account debit to grants in aid.
Grant?
Grants in aid.
Grants in aid. Bank account debit to grants in aid.
Right.
Where will you show, suppose I have to prepare a balance sheet on the first day itself. Where will you show that grants in aid?
Income expenditure. Revenue grants in income expenditure.
So, that accounting is wrong accounting. Okay. You should, on the first day when you receive that 30 rupees, the accounting should be, whatever name you give to the ledger account, grants in aid or whatever, deferred revenue, you can give any name to that ledger. Okay. The entry should be bank or cash account debit, 30 rupees to liability. So first you take that entire 30 rupees to the liability. Okay. Then what you do, when you incur the expenditure, suppose out of 30 rupees I incur 20 rupees. Okay, my entry will be expenditure 20 to bank, right? Now when I incur this expenditure, I transfer similar 20 rupees from grants to income. So that time my entry will be grant account debit to income. This is the entry I have to pass. When I receive the amount, I have to first take it to liability. When I incur the expenditure, I transfer that liability to income. This is how I pass the accounting entries.
Sir, I have told that expenditure is 100 rupees. Government has sanctioned grants 100 rupees, less internal income generation 10 rupees. Then in net approach, nothing will come in balance sheet.
At the end of the year,
nothing right. will come in the balance sheet.
Right.
In net,
at the end
net
of
approach.
The year, my grant, if I prepare a ledger for grant, say this liability, I prepare a ledger, okay, when I receive the amount, okay, I'll have a 90 rupees here, then I spend 90 rupees total, so balance zero. So in my balance sheet, this amount will be zero.
Government has sanctioned 100 rupees grant, not 90 rupees.
100 rupees.
Has given sanction letter
then
grants
I have,
of 100 rupees.
Sanctioned is different and grant given is different. Amount received.
Then how it will come in balance sheet? In net approach, nothing will come in balance sheet.
Accounting will be basis what you have received and not what has been sanctioned. Okay. Even though
according to AS-9, when I will recognize that revenue, when sanction will come?
No.
Yes. According to AS-9, revenue recognition, when sanction will come from government, then I will take in account.
See, understand this. AS-9 says income is recognized when you are sure that you have earned that income and you will receive that income. Okay.
No, there are a sanction letter on 30th March and I received the grants in my bank in April. I have to show my in my accounts that grants has been received. Grants account, yes. Grants receivable account data to grants.
On 31st March?
On 31st March.
When you have not received, you will show
yes.
that I have received in bank.
No bank, not bank. Grant receivable account data to grants.
Sir,
one
that
at a
is
time, please.
Recognition of revenue.
This is a
grants receivable account data to grants. That is recognition of revenue on 31st March.
This has happened many times in many organizations because particularly in the last week of March, remittance may take place and organizations are informed well in advance because of the likely closure of the financial year that this much money has been made, remittance has been made. It may be in transit. You go in spending because the money may actually receive in the bank account of the recipient in the first week of April. If we don't spend, the money will lapse and then all these likely expenditure which had to take place will not take place.
No, but that's a different story. See, AS 9 says there are two conditions which you have to fulfill. One is you have earned that grant, which is the sanction letter. That means you have earned it. The second is you are sure you will receive it. Okay. Now the case which you are saying that on 30th March, I have received a letter that the amount has been remitted, but your bank will receive that amount in 2 or 3 days. Now that you are sure you will receive and you have the sanction letter. So both conditions of AS9 are fulfilled. Right. Now when you talk about a situation where government has sanctioned 100 rupees, but I will receive only 90 rupees as and when I will keep on incurring the expenditure. Right? Will I receive 100 rupees cash from government?
No, 90 rupees.
90 rupees, right? Sanction is 100, but I will receive 90, right? In bits and pieces. Okay. That is a different scenario from this 30th March scenario. Do you understand that? Right. Now, in the scenario in which you are talking that sanction is 100, I will receive 90, I will record revenue or I will record that transaction only when I am sure of how much amount I am going to receive. So suppose I am going to receive 30 first, you know, I am going to receive 30,000 or 30 lakhs in the first cycle, okay. I will record only that much as liability and cash or whatever. And as and when I incur, I will keep on reducing the liability. When the second cycle comes of 40 rupees, that time I will record another 40 rupees. And the last cycle will be of only 20 then. So I need not record 100 rupees and then reverse 10 rupees. If I am receiving 100 rupees and I have to refund 10 rupees, then 100 rupees will be recorded as liability. And when I refund the 10 rupees, I will reverse the 10 rupees. Is the accounting clear?
So what happens practically, what he has explained that 10 rupees is already there in his custody, in his bank account.
Then 10 rupees will be recorded as liability. So
what is the status of that 10 rupees? Because that is a government grant or non-government grant. How it is to be taken in the books of accounts? Point is that...
See, when 100 rupees is in...
Sir, let me complete. Because the government rule says that revenues earned by the organizations cannot be retained. They have to refund.
In case
they refund,
right.
100 rupees will come from the government.
Right.
Because they are retaining 10 rupees, that's why the sanction is 100 rupees and 90 rupees remittance is coming. So now...
You are not correct. For autonomous voting, that is internal generation.
That is unexplained balance.
Right.
First of April, we prepare the budget ki our total expenditure is 100 rupees.
Right.
Our IRG, for example, we are education institute.
Internal revenue.
We said ki right. 10 rupees our tuition fee.
Right.
So government passed the 90 rupees.
Right.
So we pass the entry only for 90 rupees.
Right.
10 rupees we show as the income from the student. And suppose we make the 100 rupees.
So, right.
So, sir is confusing
government
not
is
to
also allowed
grant 100
to spend
rupees. Grant right. is only 90 rupees.
Right. Only 90 rupees.
IRG.
Absolutely. Is it clear? Okay. So there is capital approach and there is revenue approach. Capital approach, we'll talk only about fixed assets because that is relevant. Fixed assets can be by way of monetary grant, it can be non-monetary grant. When it is monetary grant, I said there are two options. I show it at nominal value of a rupee one or I show liability and asset both. Okay. When it is non-monetary grant is that means you are given an asset, you are not given money. So you are given a furniture or you are given a plant or you are given some asset. At that time, you have only one option which is to record it at rupee one. Okay, so monetary grant you have two options, non-monetary grant only one option which is recorded at nominal value. Okay, if it is revenue approach, then you have to first take it to liability and then record as other income as and when you keep on incurring the expenditure. Okay, there is no refund of government grants except when you have not utilized it. So unutilized part, so that's what. So any amount which is refundable because you have not utilized, that part will remain in your liability because I have booked the entire amount. Say suppose over here, I have booked 40 as liability. I have utilized 20. So 20 is already there in my liability side. So simple, when I refund it, my entry will be liability to bank. Okay, there is no P&L or income and expenditure involved in that scenario. Okay, disclosure requirements, you have to give details of what method of approach you have followed, whether capital approach or revenue approach. That means whatever fixed assets you have got grant, you have to disclose that these assets we have got grant and this is capital approach, these expenditure we have got grant and this is revenue approach. Okay. Method of accounting followed, that means we discussed that you have followed option 2, that means you show asset and liability both, so that you have to disclose. Okay. Nature and extent to which you have recognized as income or grant, whatever grant you have recognized, whether in capital fund or whether in income, that you have to disclose. Separate disclosure for non-monetary grants. Any non-monetary grant if you have received, you have to separately disclose in notes to accounts. And description of grant refunded during the year. So any grant if you have refunded, you show it separately in notes to accounts that this much amount unutilized has been refunded. So this is basically the summary which we have discussed. Now these are questions which I want you all to answer. Okay. What do you do when you receive a sanction letter or a notification that you will receive a grant? Okay, which amongst the options is right? You will do nothing until the cash is received, or you will record it on accrual basis, and you have to answer me what is accrual basis if you select this option, or you will open an account receivable, but the grant will be recognized when the cash is received. Account receivable means debtors, right? So basically, okay, and what is accrual basis?
Amount receivable.
When will you say that income has been accrued? When the two conditions which I said is fulfilled, that means one, you have the sanction letter in hand, and two, you are sure how much amount you are going to receive. When these two conditions are fulfilled, it is called it has been accrued but not received. When the government grant is in form of land, and at no cost, that means land has been allotted to you for free, okay, for your institution, land has been given to you for free, then what will you do?
Nominal, Rupee 1.
Third one, it will be recorded at nominal value at Rupee 1.
Rupee 1.
Absolutely. Amount refundable in respect of grant related to revenue should be applied first against capital profit, or first against current profit, or first against unamortized deferred credit. So basically unamortized deferred credit is your liability side. So whatever is refundable should be taken from that liability. So your income and expenditure account should not be affected. Okay, this is not a normal case. I know this is not a government case, but government company or institution case. This can be a case with private companies. Sometimes they don't fulfill certain conditions of the government, and they have to refund the grant because of that. Okay. So what do they do? You know, when they have to refund the grant, they don't increase or decrease the book value. They give effect in general reserve or your capital reserve. So thank you so much.